Hey, Coach, man, what time is it?
Oh, Slim, you know what time it is. 6 o'clock, straight up and down. It's Homespun Sports with Coach John Montgomery. Sports talk with a twist of down-home wisdom. Welcome. We are so glad you are here. Once more and again, you tuned in to Homespun Sports. It's sports talk with just a twist of down home wisdom. I am your host, the coach, John Montgomery. I'm right here in good old Houston, Texas, way up there in Dale City, Oklahoma, ride or die. What's up, Slim?
I can't call it, Coach. How you doing, man?
Oh, man, dude, I am so excited for Homespun Sports episode number 40. Our very special guest, ladies and gentlemen, every football coach in America, every football program in America, if you play good special teams, you have borrowed some of this man's work. Mike Westhoff is the icon of special team football. NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell simply put it, Mike Westhoff is the greatest special team coach in the history of the National Football League. He is now a best-selling author. His book, Figure It Out, is on the market right now. It's a great read. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please make welcome Coach Mike Westhoff.
Okay, I'm going to correct you on one thing, okay?
All right.
I'm going to correct you. What Roger Goodell said on the cover of my book, when the publisher, they write a review of the book that they wrote, that's the best special teams coach. Roger Goodell was quoted when we were at a celebration of life this fall for Don Shula. Roger Goodell was talking with me, and he was telling some people about some of the things that I had done. He was teasing me a little bit, but then he said, in the National Football League, he said, Mike Westhoff changed the game. And I think that's a very nice quote coming from that gentleman. I was proud of that. But that's exactly what he said. So I want to make sure we give him the right words and not the wrong ones. I don't want to get him upset. But that's what it was. No, you. It was on the book, but it was not. It was not related. That one was not to him.
Okay.
That's
okay.
All. Well, that's pretty simple.
We are certainly blessed. I tell you what, Slim. We're in tall cotton here at Homespun Sports. We are misquoting Roger Goodell, and we got the great Mike Westhoff all in the same package.
We're just going to make sure we get things as close, as accurate as we can. We want to be very fair. So it's no big deal. But that's correct.
Absolutely. You know, Mike, coaching is all about the ability to convey. And in 2009, I was a minority apprentice coach in the Bill Walsh Minority Apprenticeship Program, and I did an internship with the Jets. Rex Ryan and I go back to 1996 when we were both assistants at the University of Cincinnati. So Rex invited me up, and he knew I knew Bill Callahan, so I was following Bill around, and I stuck my head in one of your special team meetings. You coaching the special team for the Jets. And Mike, I heard you tell a story that was so inspirational. And about the devil's biggest selling item. Share that with our audience, Mike.
Okay. All right. I'm going to preface it just a little bit, if I can, for a second. I believe that coaching is very much, as you just put it, communicating, to say the least. That's what it's about, and to make our points. I always believed that coaching in the National Football League in particular, because we had so much time, was made up of several premises. One, you better know your subject. You better know it, because you're going to have to teach it, and you better know it. And then you have to be able to communicate it in a different ways to different people, because you're dealing with all levels of backgrounds of how they perceive things. That's okay. You have to understand that. Then I think there's a part that you have to be able to respect that guy that's sitting in front of you or across from you. You have to have that, a realm of respect, or you're not going to get anywhere. And I also sometimes believe that coaching was a little bit of entertaining. But I think sometimes you got to keep them alive. Now, I don't mean to be a funny or a comedian or something like that. It's just to dramatize. And I know that when I was in training camp at that time, we were about three or so weeks in, you'll remember. And you know how hard that gets. I mean, they're beat up. Also the overzealous enthusiasm begins to wane. Because now all of a sudden that guy, when he walked in there a few weeks ago, and he thought, oh, hell, this is great. I can make this football team. Well, now he looks around and he goes, uh-oh, this is pretty tough. These guys are really good. And, you know, I'm just a young kid out of college. I'm trying to make this team. And I look around and, you know, here's Darrell Revis making $23 million a year. They're probably going to keep him.
You think?
Yeah, they'll probably keep him. And so, you know, and so they get discouraged. They get discouraged. And so, you know, I look at that face in that crowd, and I know that's the first step toward defeat. I'm sure of it, because I've seen it a million times. So I told him a story, and I actually heard it. I heard it in a different way, but I heard it in church. I'm Catholic, and I heard it in Mass. Okay. It was a little different, but it was the same line. So I took the story and altered it a little bit. And the devil was in New York. The devil's in New York. Yeah, just, you got it. The devil's in New York, and he's having a going out of business sale. And he's moving from one area. Actually, when I told the story the first time, he was moving from down by Wall Street, because he already got all those guys, because they have no hope on those guys. So he got them. And so he was moving up to the Upper East Side, and he was selling everything in his store. And a gentleman came in, was looking around, walking around, and he said to him, "What are you doing?" And he said, "I'm having a going out of business sale." He said, "I got all the souls down here I need. I'm just headed for another area." Okay. They kind of laughed. And the guy said, "Okay." And he said, "What's your best seller?" And he said, "I have a lot of money." And he said, "I can buy anything. Tell me what's your best seller, because I want it." The devil looked at him and he said, "That's a simple one." He said, "Because my best seller is discouragement." He said, "Because as soon as people get discouraged, they lose everything that they have to have to fight their way through tough times. They don't get up as early. They don't work as hard. They might not make their bed. Whatever it is, you can see it falling into place. They begin to lose hope. They get discouraged." And now, the devil said, now that I've got that person in that position, everything I have works. I can do anything with the guy. I got him. So the key thing is I let them know, you know, I'm not here to save your souls, but I was there to save their careers. And I said, you know, you fought so hard to get here. Of everyone that starts playing football in America, less than 1% make it in the National Football League. Now, that's a very, very difficult statistic to have to deal with, but that's the reality. And so what I was trying to let these guys know, you've already achieved a great goal. When you're my age, you're 74 like I am, and you've got grandchildren, you can sit around and no matter what happened to you, you can tell them a great story because you were in a great position. I said, so what the last thing that you want to do is get discouraged and give up. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. It's not the end of the world. But take this experience and move it forward. I said, I know one thing for sure. You can't go out there tomorrow and line up against those veterans. If you don't have all, you better have your A game, buddy, because if you line up against those guys, they can bring it.
There you go.
And this is a tough business. And so I just wanted them to know every week, every time I spoke, I had some type of message or story that I used to build a point. It's almost like I used to tease some of the guys said, "Oh, you know, coach, you can think of a story for everything." I said, "Yeah, I can actually. I'll even bet you." I said, "You throw something out, I'll give you a story for it." And they think that I just made it all up, but I didn't. I had a computer file, and I kept it. I read a lot, and I kept everything. And I had all these things on file, and I would go through it and through it and through it. So they thought it was extemporaneous, but it wasn't. I was really working at it. So I just believed that no matter what, I wanted to be a little bit entertaining. I wanted to be able to make them laugh or make them smile or maybe choke them up a little bit. Whatever it took, I didn't care. I only cared about the end result. Making them the best football player possible. And I had a very high bar that I set. I mean, it was Tom Morstead, who's a punter down at the Saints, was a great, great punter. And I had him in 2017 and 18. And he was in the book. He was quoted. He was interviewed. And he said, playing for Mike was really difficult. He said, it's tough. He said, because he's hard. He said, he can really be hard. He said, you know, he said he had, I can't use the language. But he said, I had a terrible day in practice one day. And I walked off the field and Mike just looked at me and he said, my six-year-old grandson can blank and punt better than that.
Okay.
And he said, he said, I was so mad at him. He said, but then I looked around, I thought, you know, he's 100% right. He said, I have a bar up here and he will not let me do anything other than get to that bar. And that's what I tried to do with everything I communicated. And so it's all done in different ways. We all have different backgrounds. We all have different cultures. We have different religions. But in the National Football League, none of it matters.
There you go.
Because we only have one goal, and that's to be a good football team. And everything else you have to figure out. And that's what I wrote a book about. The book's entitled Figure It Out. And I'm very proud of it.
That's where the title came from, Mike.
That's where it came from. Yes, sir. It came from right there. It came from that. It's what I did. I grew up in a city in a row house. We didn't have much money. We had six children. The only way I could get to college is if I got a football scholarship. Though I had to figure it out. I figured it out. I learned how to do that. I wasn't a real good student. I learned. I figured it out. And I became a pretty good student. It took me a long time, but I figured it out. So that's what I wrote the book about. And it's about these kinds of guys that came in from nowhere and had a dramatic, dramatic influence on play in the NFL. Now, you should remember, because when you were there, that group that I had, whoa, we were good now.
You had some dogs.
We'd knock your head off. We had some dogs, is right. We were tough. I mean, we played well. We had great return guys. We had a good kicker. You know, we were just a good group that could help win the football game, and we knew it. And we put that pressure on ourselves. And so that night, to tell you the truth, I was probably talking to maybe three or four people in that room that really had a chance to make it if they didn't get discouraged and give up.
Mike, I remember what was so profound, because, dude, I'm standing in the back room. I know you didn't see me because you were busy preaching.
And no, I saw you. I see everything.
And I'm like, because you told them, Mike, you said, understand something. Look around this room. They're not going to be but maybe three or four guys in this room make this team. But I will promise you this. You have not a snowball's chance in hell of making this team if you get discouraged.
That's correct.
So you get, and you told them, Mike,
three or four new guys. Yeah, yeah. There'll be more than three, of course, make it, but three or four new ones, that's probably right. That's probably correct.
Yeah. Yeah. You said, so you get discouraged if you want to. You'll be out of here so fast. And that was that ability to communicate that point. Just, man, like I said, I shared the story. I didn't tell anybody as good as you, Mike, but wow, man, let me tell you.
It's something I loved. I loved doing. When I look at those guys, I used to walk in that room and I'd look at that group of faces. And what I saw is I would look at them. Of course, I know that some I just knew they just don't have the physical ability. And, you know, they're going to have a tough time to make it. But you see others that have a chance. And I used to think to myself, I'm going to change their life. This is going to change their life. They're going to get a chance to make some money. They can get a career for themselves. They can take care of their family. And they can do things that they've never been able to do. All I have to do is find a way to make sure I put them in the right place, get them in the right spot, and give them things to do that they understand, that they learn, and they know how to do it. Then let their talent take over. That's my job. My job is to take care of that, and I love that. I love that. I love seeing that guy come out of nowhere that nobody knew about. And, you know, I mean, I remember going out to a place to work a guy out, and, you know, one of our scouts said to, you know, Mike, why are you going out there? And I said, I did some research. I'm going to take a good look at this kid. And he said, oh, Mike, he said, he don't have a chance. He said, the Canadian League turned him down. I said, I don't care. I know I can beat the hell out of the Canadian League. I don't care about those guys. I said, I don't care. What do I care? I said, I think he's a football player. Well, he played 13 years. So maybe I was right. No, I can't tell you. I can't tell you. I can't tell you. I'm sorry. It wouldn't be fair to him. Okay. It wouldn't be fair to him. Okay. But he made it. And he worked hard. He deserved to play.
And so, he had a 13-year career, Mike.
Yes, he did. Yeah, he was a backup player, special teams, very good. Went to a couple Pro Bowls. He was a heck of a player. But again, the point is, you know, I got to give him the chance. And I had so many things that I formed my how I did this, people that helped me gain this knowledge, you know, that I wrote about. I mean, you know, people, all the great coaches. Of course, I was with Don Shula for all those years, so I learned a few things from that guy. Yeah. I mean, he was a pretty good coach. And you know, things like Woody Hayes, Bear Bryant, you know, Bill Walsh, Mike Ditka, all of these guys, Bob Knight, that I had things.
Indiana. Things like, Indy, you're a Hoosier. But
I went to grad school there.
But Mike, let's back up because we got something in common. I didn't know it till I was reading about you in Wikipedia. You're a Shocker.
Yes, that's correct.
I worked for Willie Jeffries.
Did you really?
Yeah.
No
kidding. I was Willie Jeffries' running back coach at Wichita State.
Oh.
Absolutely. But hey, listen now. A lot of people don't know this, but Bill Parcells,
he Wichita played there.
State. Shocker. Jimmy Johnson broke in coaching.
That's Wichita correct. State. He was there when I was there.
You were there with Jimmy?
Yeah, sure.
Wow.
I was on that team. I played there. And he was only there 1 year, and then he left. And then, you know, they were going through such a turmoil at the time. But I transferred there from the University of Wyoming. When George Karras was the head coach, Bill Parcells was the defensive coordinator, and I played there then. I started there a couple years. I was most valuable player. I was captain. I enjoyed it. It was tough because, you know, there were people transferring and coaching changes. We had to go through some of that mess, but I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it, and I'm very proud of what I was able to do.
You mentioned Bobby Knight. I'm a Bobby Knight fan. How did he influence you? He's a basketball
okay.
guy.
I can't give away my whole book here, okay, but I'll tell you a little bit of the story. I won't give you the whole story, but I'll tell you part of it, okay? When I was in graduate school at Indiana University, I worked with Lee Corso, and
right.
I was there. I was coaching defense, actually, with him. I got my master's degree in psychology, educational, but it's psychology.
Okay.
And I'm proud of it. I got all A's in school. I did pretty well. I figured that student thing out. It took me a while. Anyway, I got to know Coach Knight a little bit. Not real well, just a little bit. But I was at Miami, and we were going to the Combine. And I put a call in to him, and I asked him if I could come to a basketball game, that I'd love to come down. I brought our strength coach, a guy named Junior Wade, came with me. And Bob Knight said, sure, I'll leave 2 tickets for you. So I was sitting right behind the bench. And after the game, Coach Knight turned to me and he said, come on, follow, come down to the dressing room with me, which is, nobody gets to go in his dressing room, but I did. So we go down, he puts us in this little room, and he said, look, I have to deal with the team. They won, they beat Wisconsin. And he said, and then the media, and I'll be in the sea in a few minutes. So I'm sitting in there, and Bill Belichick comes in.
Wow. Well,
at the time, Bill Belichick was the defensive coordinator with the New York Giants.
Right. Okay.
Well,
right.
You know, talking to Bill is not the easiest thing, to be honest with you. It's a little awkward sometimes. I'm being kind. Anyway, in a little while, Coach Knight comes back in and he said, Mike, do you know Bill? And I said, well, yes, I certainly know who he is. I don't know him very well, but I know him. And he said, well, when I was the head basketball coach at West Point, he said, Bill Parcells was on the football staff there and we became friends. He said, and Bill Parcells just recently called me and asked me to teach Bill Belichick footwork and technique and hands. And as he kept calling it, he kept calling it how to guard. We would call it how to cover.
Okay.
So
okay.
Bill Parcells gets Bob Knight to teach Bill Belichick how to use basketball footwork, technique, hand placement, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and goes on. And I sat there for an hour. And listen, now there's another part of the story, but I'm not going to tell you this part because you've got to buy the book. I hope you do. I promise you, you'll enjoy it.
I promise you. I'm going to buy the book.
It's a good story. It's about those kind of guys. But anyway, it's just something that you know, I was a part of, and I sat there and listened to him. And I mean, here's one of the greatest basketball coaches ever teaching one of the greatest football coaches ever how to use basketball technique, footwork, hand placement, et cetera, to make him better in his coverage.
And there was a young guy, no doubt, young then, by the name of Mike Krzyzewski, that wasn't too far, that you know got some of that same teaching.
Mike was on the staff at that time. He was working for them. You talk about, there's some pretty good people around. I just happened to be right in the middle of a bunch of it, and I learned a lot. I mean, I was at that same place at Indiana. I'm not giving my whole book away, but Lee Corso came up to me. We had a gentleman who had coached there for a long time, a guy named Howard Brown that had died. And Lee came and gave me his car keys. He said, Mike, I want you to drive up to Indianapolis and pick up Woody Hayes. He said, Woody Hayes is coming over for the funeral, and I need you to be his host and show him around, da-da-da-da-da. Okay, so I go get Woody Hayes. So for 2.5 days, I took Woody Hayes everywhere, just he and I.
Yeah.
You know, to where he had to go, to the church services, to the funeral, everything. And we were driving back. He and I got in a conversation. Again, I won't tell you the whole conversation, but okay. I'll tell you part of it. I'll tell you one part of it. Woody Hayes said to me, we had been talking about something, and he was talking to me about it. And he said, Coach, I'm going to give you a piece of advice. I said, okay. He said, never let a number, high, low, never let a number make up your mind about whether or not a guy's a football player. He said, don't let it happen. He said, look beyond the number. Well, I'll give an example. I went out to Texas Tech. I was the only coach. Now, there were plenty of scouts that went, but I was the coach. Okay. Zach Thomas was 5'10 and a half, and he weighed 223 pounds, and he's a linebacker.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just like...
Hey, listen, you preach it to the choir when you talk about Zach Thomas, but come on.
So you know what I'm talking about. He played what, 14 years in the NFL? He went to 100 Pro Bowls. I believe he'll go in the Hall of Fame, and he deserves to go.
Listen. Sam Mills is going to Canton. Congratulations. Zach Thomas deserves to be in Canton. No
absolutely. Point. There's absolutely correct. You're absolutely right. But anyway, all those types of things helped me form who I was and what I became. And there's dozens more. So the book is Figure It Out. It'll be out July 12th. You can get it in Barnes & Noble. You get it on Amazon. You can actually get it through the publisher today, Mascot Books. But you can get it in a couple weeks through those guys, and they'll deliver it right to your house. And I think you'll enjoy it. I'm proud of it. Plus, I wrote it, but there's a guy that helped me. And then he conducted the interviews. So you're going to hear me tell the story, but then you're going to hear Leon Washington tell the story. You're going to hear Zach Thomas tell the story. You're going to hear Taysom Hill talk about what he did down at New Orleans, and Sean Payton. And then we blended it all together. But I wrote every word, and it tells a very good story of a part of the National Football League that when I came almost didn't exist. You know, special teams were kind of spread out among the staff back in the day. There were really no coordinators. And then then I helped take it to a particular point. I mean, I think I did more than help take it. I think I took it, but that's just me. I'm a little cocky sometimes. And then with the rules, the way the rules have changed things, it's kind of been diluted and watered down a little bit, so you don't have as many plays. And that's just part of the game. That's what it is today. The game's changed. But I was part of the great rise in it, and that's how I did it. I just did it by figuring it out. I developed philosophies, And I did it all while going through some pretty tough things myself physically that I had to do. I fought through cancer and I did some stuff. I didn't let it define me. You know, I had to, if I had to use a cane, I used a cane. So what? I didn't care. I just did it. Was it fun? No, but I did it.
In 2000, I remember, Mike, you walking around, we're in SUNY Cortland, New York, and you were walking around, you were on a cane then.
Yes, I was. Yeah.
Well, Mike, Tony Dungy once said, make sure your C students make B's, make sure your B students make A's.
That's correct.
And that's what you did, Mike.
Yes, I think I did. That's a very good way. You know, I've actually never heard it said that way. I wish I had said that. That's pretty good. I kind of like that. That's a good one. No, it's a good way. I always said, you know, make your average players good players and make your good players great players.
Ain't no
but
question.
Make the C to B and B to A is another nice way of putting it. But that's what you have to do. And what I did is I'll tell you how it came. I was forced to do it. I'll tell you why. I'm at Miami, okay? Now, Don Shula and, of course, Dan Marino. Well, you know, right. We built that football team around Dan. That's what you have to do. So now we have, you know, receivers and all kinds of guys that we're keeping. I'll just give a name, and I love to tease him. Joe Rose, he was sort of a tight end, you know, kind of an undersized tight end. But Joe could catch the ball. But Joe, you want a first down, throw it to Joe. But then Coach Shula would say to me, Mike, why don't you put Joe Rose on the kickoff team? I was like, whoa, excuse me. So I told Joe, I said, you're the reason I became a good coach. I had to figure out what to do with you. I was teasing.
Figure it out.
So I used to put him where they were going to double team because I knew he couldn't make the tackle anyway. So I'd let him double team him. The guy next to him would kill him. So it was pretty fun. But, you know, so I had to become creative and I had to move people. But then I learned that as a special teams coach, I had a timeout before every play because there's like the clock stopped. After change of possession, after a score, kickoff return. So I started drawing everything and I got really good at it. And I had all these drawings. You've seen, you remember me doing this.
I
had them all.
Oh, yeah.
So instead of having two kickoff returns, I'd have 12. I'd have 12. So I could stand in the huddle and I'd say, okay, Slim, take a look. Now this time I want you over here. Da-da-da. And you never make a mistake. You're never going to make a mistake and you're going to know what to do and you're going to do it 1,000 miles an hour. So we became really good. And that's how it happened.
Is that where the phrase, how they coined the nickname for you, the mad scientist?
Yes, that's where it came from. Yeah,
that's where it came from.
I don't know if that's where it came from. That's where it was. Yeah, they called me that all the time.
That sounds bad.
I had lots of nicknames. They weren't always that nice. That's where it came from. And that's what I believe sometimes coaching's about. It's figuring it out. Take what you have. You know, I used to have a lot of signs in my office. I had a great, beautiful office up there in Florham Park. And I had a sign that read, you can't win with the players you don't have.
Okay.
You can't win with the players you don't have. I didn't have Devin Hester. So what? I love him. I wish I had him, but I didn't have him. But I had nine different guys that led the National Football League in returns when I was with the New York Jets. Now, nobody's touching that record. Nobody's touching it because you don't have any returns anymore. Wow. So, you know, for me, it was the perfect time and the perfect place. I just had to kind of figure it out, be creative, try different things. Also, at that time, there was very little regulation. You could do anything. Though, you know, some of the stuff that we did, it was a little tough, and they changed some of the rules because of us. But that's okay. You know, we played a very tough physical brand of football, and I believed in it. And not dirty and not cheap. I never taught hit above the shoulders or below the knees, never. But everywhere else, we're going to hit you. You better look out. You better know the A game. You better have your A game, buddy, because we're pretty good. And so that's how it developed. And I was able to write about all this and talk about it. It took me 2.5 years to write this book, but it was really fun. I think I know you'll enjoy it. It's easy to read. You'll pick it up and you'll go through it. And I think you'll recognize a lot of it. You'll see a lot of things in it yourself as a coach. You'll know sometimes this is you know when you do it right and you know when you could do it better. We all do. It's all part of it. And the thing is, You got to let players know that there's an exactness to this business. I mean, I used to have a thing where, I mean, I was really tough. If we had a double team on the 22-yard line, you better be on the 22. You don't be on the 23 because I was tough. I mean, I was really hard. And I know, and sometimes it doesn't, you're not the most popular guy. And I knew that, and I knew it. And but I knew when it was all done, when it was all over, they'd look back and they'd say, you know, that guy that I used to want to kill, he's actually a pretty good guy. And that's how it all comes around. It comes, like I got it, one of the guys in there was with us with the Jets. He might have still been there when you were there, an offensive tight end. And he long snapped for me, James Dirth, real tough guy. Great kid,
him.
Big, 280 pounds, all muscle. Well, he wrote in the book about how hard I worked him, and I made him work. He said, Mike would bring me up to Hofstra. This was back when we were out on Long Island. And he said I would practice on Sunday. He'd bring me on Sunday. He said, that's the good news. He said, the bad news, Easter Sunday. He made him practice on Easter Sunday. He said, but what it did, he said, enabled me to play 9 years in the NFL and get my family set for the rest of their lives.
Wow. Wow.
I don't care about anything else. That's my favorite part.
You know, Florham Park, the facility in Florham Park, New Jersey. So I'm walking in there the very first day, and the genuineness, the camaraderie, good teachers, good people. I remember sitting in Anthony Lynn's office, man, yes, just soaking it in. And Anthony Lynn said, where you from, man? And I told him, he said, I coached running backs before I coached O-line. And he said, I'm a running back coach, man. He threw me the dry marker board. Draw the power up on the board. And Van Buten just sit up there, draw the inside zone. How do you block that against an over or an under? And man, just get, and Anthony's been on our show once, and he said he's coming back, would go down to Dennis Thurman's office and just sit down there. All the men, and Dennis is down there now with Dion at Jackson State, his D coordinator. But good men and great teachers. And Mike, man, that no wonder you guys were so successful.
That was a good – John Gruden, he came out – remember during the lockout the year after that?
Okay.
John Gruden came out to visit us, and he and I became pretty good friends. And he told me, he said, that's the best NFL coaching staff he had ever seen.
Wow.
Don't forget, Bill Callahan's the offensive line coach.
I followed Mike.
Mike Pettine's a coordinator. You had Rex. You had Anthony Lynn. And myself, Ben Kotwika is my assistant. He's been a coordinator in the NFL. I mean, we were the real deal. And we had really good people as players. You're 100% correct. That's the key.
The quality control guy was Mike Bloomberg.
I know.
The head coach at Rice now.
Right, I know.
First class guy. Went on to Stanford and was the O-line coach there when they had those good teams at Stanford.
When Stanford was
going to the Rose Bowl and they were knocking people off the ball. He was
the offensive line coach there. It was a good group. And we had good players. I mean, just look at the offensive line. I mean, you got the Brickishaw Ferguson, Nick Mangold. Wait a minute. Alan Faneca is playing guard. He's in the Hall of Fame.
He's in Canton.
And you got Damian Woody's the other guard. Are you kidding me? I mean, those guys, no wonder we could run the ball. Oh, by the way, and LaDainian Tomlinson's carrying the ball.
Yeah.
He got a gold jacket too.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you wonder why we could run the football? Look at that group with Bill Callahan coaching them. I mean, this was a good group. We had a good football team. And on defense, you got Darrell Revis and Cromartie and those guys, Bart Scott. I mean, it was Rex used to put Revis on one side and 10 on the other. He put, go ahead, play over there. I mean, that's the kind of stuff we did. It was just so much fun. And, I had Leon Washington, those kind of guys. I had Brad Smith, Eric Smith, James Ahidobo. James Ahidobo hits you, forget. I'm telling you, you're hearing voices of deceased relatives when he hits you. When that guy hits you, I mean, woo. He's tough.
Mike, Rex used to say all the time, I will not tolerate mental errors. I won't have it. I will cut you so fast. I won't have mental errors. And I'm going to tell you why. We will not make mental errors because I promise you, nobody will beat us physically. Nobody.
I mean, he used to say that kind of stuff. Sure he did. He believed it. But we were that kind of team. We had... Of course, for me, it was very easy. because I told you the system that I had where I had everything drawn. Mm-hmm. And, you know, matter of fact, I remember getting in an argument one time with actually Marty Schottenheimer, God rest his soul. But we were talking about some things, and he said, you know, about making mistakes. And I said, Marty, I went through the whole year last year. We didn't have a mental error. Oh, he got all, oh, yeah. I said, well, I'm just telling you, I didn't have a mental error. I had some penalties. We didn't make the, you know, we lost the block. Sure, we didn't beat everybody. Of course not. But we knew who to block. We knew who to play. We just knew it. And I just showed it to him. Nobody's going to, so I didn't have a mental error whole season. Not even one. And so, you know, yeah, did we make other mistakes? Sure, of course we did. Sure we did. That's what, that's what the game's about. But I was very proud that I came up with a system that could be so readily, make them understand it so quickly, and that they could really become a part of it and become a viable contributor. Because I knew when they would run out there that they, I mean, I remember guys telling me later on in their lives that they'd walk out on the field and they'd look across that line over there and they'd, those guys are scared to death. They knew we were really good. Though it was, for me, it was just the greatest experience in my life.
So, Mike, what are you doing now, man? You go around the NFL teams? You still doing something?
No, I don't. Yeah, I got out of the media. I quit doing that because that became difficult. And the pandemic knocked me out of that anyway. I didn't want to deal with that then. I didn't want to travel all over when that was going on. And I went back to work for the Saints for a couple years. That was a ball. I loved that team. Sean Payton's a great coach. Mickey Lomas, a tremendous general manager. I was there with Drew Brees and, you know, when Mike Thomas was playing, he was catching anything you threw. I mean, those were really fun times. It was a great football team. And we should have gone to 2 Super Bowls. It's a crime that that didn't happen. Everybody knows that. Yeah, we should have gone. There's no doubt about it. It just the way it worked. Minnesota beat us on that crazy play. If we're in a 3-deep coverage, that had never happened. And then the crazy call with the Rams, the non-penalty call. I mean, come on, guys.
Pass interference. No question.
That was a foul. They find the guy the next day for helmet to helmet. They find him. We don't get the call.
So you don't get the call.
It was anyway. And then I spent this time writing the book. So right now I'm helping publicize the book, which is what I'm doing with you guys, obviously, and talking with you. And it helps me. People watch your show, and hopefully they'll go and buy the book. And I do that. I live in Florida. I like where I live. I go fishing. I have a boat. I like to go out. I go out at least once a week, sometimes twice.
Okay. So, Mike, before we let you get out of here, so you got scheduled book signings?
Not yet. Not yet. I don't have the signings yet. I don't know how we're exactly. I've got all types of things where media I'm going on. I'm trying to. You know, I've got to go up to Tampa and go on their television station this Friday. I've got ESPN, all those people. I'm trying to, you know, to all really push the book heavily. And then how the signings go, it's not set up yet. I'm going to do one here where I live, and then at this country club I live at, they're going to have, they call it a launch. Okay. And they'll have people that'll be there, and the media will be there, and, you know, try to get it going. Because it's not officially out yet. Now, I've sold quite a few, but I've sold them through the publisher.
Okay.
So it's not officially released until July 12th, and then you can get the audio book. You can get it on, you know, like some people like to read on their computers, on their iPad. Sure. You can get it that way. You can go in a store and buy a soft cover. You can buy a hard cover. You know, you can get anything like that. Sure. It's got a great cover. I think it's a good, really a good book. Figure it out. Figure it out. You'll be able to get it then.
Figure it out. Well, listen, Mike, you certainly have figured it out. And listen, my brother. Don't you come to Houston, Texas without letting me know. I'm going to take you out to eat some of the best barbecue you ever put in your mouth. And Mike, listen.
That'd be great. I like that. I'd be very happy to do that.
God bless you, man. Thanks so much for coming on our show. Well, figure it out, folks.
Bless you guys.
Figure it out. This.
Thank you for saying that. I'll tell you what I'd like you to do.
What?
Go ahead and get it. Get it. Read it. Get a hold of me and let me know what you think, please.
I promise you I will. I promise you I will, Mike.
I hope you do that. I'll come back maybe in a few weeks when you're down the road and we talk about it a little bit and tell me what you think. Give me your impression. I can take criticism, not real well, but I take it a little bit.
Mike, I've been talking about your book for the last 2 weeks on our show.
Thank you.
I'm just glad we had a chance to get you on so you could tell your story. And again, Mike, thanks so much for coming on, man.
No, it was fun. I can't wait to get it. It was fun. You guys did a good job. I'm really proud to be on with you and do it anytime. So again, thank you for having me. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. God bless you, my brother.
All right, bless you. Thanks, guys.
Take care.
No, ladies and gentlemen, please don't forget July 12th. Figure It Out. Amazon, anywhere you buy books, Barnes & Noble. Again, anywhere you buy books, y'all got to make sure y'all check this book out.
Yeah, Slim. Slim, I'm buying that book, though. Ain't no question. Yeah,
look, I want mine autographed, Coach. I'm going to give me mine.
Okay. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time once again for Slim's Pickings. Go ahead, bro.
What in the wide, wide world of sports is going on here?
Way to go, P. Diddy, for your gift of $1 million to not only Jackson State's football program, but your alma mater of Howard University. That's the type of things that we need, ladies and gentlemen. We need more iconic millionaires and the few black billionaires that we have to adopt this same philanthropic spirit. You know, I was only 3 years old when we lived in Atlanta and Pops was coaching at Morehouse for Doug Williams. Spike Lee Morehouse class of 1979 gifted an entire slew of high-tech computers and technology, and that was back in 70, and that was back in 97. Wake up. You guys have to realize that the gifts that you choose to grant to these HBCUs, that's the only thing that's going to level this playing field right now. There's an old saying in recruiting.
If you build it, you will come.
I'm talking about those facilities. Now, the charge is on you, Eddie George, head football coach at Tennessee State, and you, Hugh Jackson, head football coach at Grambling State, because we have proven it on our show. And as a matter of fact, episode 33, Buddy Pugh, we had Buddy Pugh on our show, and he made it perfectly clear that he doesn't buy into the whole NIL, all these monies given to these facilities. We don't need that. The Toyota commercial, this is an old school Toyota commercial, and it said,
"You ask for it, you got it, Toyota."
Stay tuned, sports fans. And that's Slim's Pickings.
Hell of a job. Hell of a job, bro.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, man. Eddie George at Tennessee State and Hugh Jackson at Grambling. Slim. These two guys their star power must generate funds. At the end of the day, that's why they were brought there. We had Doug Williams on our show, and Doug said, Grambling need a shot in the arm. Well, they went out and got Hugh Jackson, been a head coach in the NFL, two different programs, okay? Been a head coach in the NFL twice. Eddie George, NFL icon, great player with the Tennessee Titans. He's the head coach now at Tennessee State. The folks you rub shoulders with, okay, before you got to
generate some money, Coach.
Thank you. Absolutely.
And if you can't do that, you basically wasted your time. Because that's what they brought him in to do what Deion Sanders did at Jackson State.
There ain't no question. There's no question. So that is very, very I'm gonna follow that with keen interest. I know when we were at Morehouse, I used to love to go to the airport with Doug. Slim, you would be surprised at the celebrities, famous people, when they off the camera and they ain't got their makeup on or they just dressed in plain clothes, how well they blend in with the crowd and you can't detect them. We was in the airport terminal at the Delta hub in Atlanta waiting to pick up some recruits, Doug Williams and I. And all of a sudden, this little old guy, about 5'8", comes running up in front of Doug's face. He goes, "You're Doug Williams. Man, I followed your whole career. Man, I just wanted to shake your hand. Man, I watched you win the Super Bowl. MVP. You're Doug Williams. Man, oh, man." he shook his head and then he just took off. And Doug looked at me and because I knew who he was. Slim, Tom Cruise, dude. And Doug was like, is that who I thought it was? I said, yeah, bro. That's Tom Cruise. Star power. That's my point. Star power. If Hugh Jackson don't generate star with his star power, and he got on there talking about, well, Grambling needs $5
million. $5 million.
To fix all the problems at Grambling. Newsflash, $5 million fix everybody, all HBCU's problems. They didn't bring you to Grambling to beg. They brought you to Grambling to generate money.
Coach, so in your opinion, Coach, Hugh Jackson and Eddie George, which one of those coaches you think will be successful?
Well, I'll tell you this much. Eddie been there now, I think, a year. Eddie George been there a year. And I think he going to be, my personal opinion, I think he going to do better. Because Hugh Jackson got off to a bad start. When he started off trying to hire Art Briles.
Yeah.
Okay? So he's an outsider by that move that he made. Now he's down there begging, talking about $5 million will fix all our problems. Oh, okay. They ain't bring you there to beg, Hugh Jackson. They brought you there to generate money. Okay, your star power supposed to do for Grambling what Deion Sanders' star power is doing for Jackson State.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. So, Coach, we got two trials that we got to chop up. The first one, as we speak, Brittany Griner's, the trial will continue July the 7th. And she could be facing up to 10 years in the penitentiary if she is convicted. She was led into the courtroom in handcuffs and put in a cage with only a bottle of water and a bag of cookies. How inhumane is that? I mean, in your opinion, Pops, do you think Putin got the United States by the short hairs right now?
Ain't no question. Putin got Brittany Griner is a pawn. That's what she is, okay? And okay. Slim, the timing of this whole thing, Brittany Griner been coming in and out of from Russia, traveling abroad, going from the United States back to Russia. Why all of a sudden now is she stopped? Could it be because of Russia's involvement in the Ukraine? Okay? But at the end of the day, okay, Brittany Griner is a pawn. And the United States gonna have to cut the deal, okay? Yeah. Jesus talked about the ox being in the ditch, okay? You got to break the rules sometimes to bless somebody, okay? Now, at the end of the day, there's a man named, what's that guy named? Victor Bout?
Victor Bout, Coach. Victor Bout.
All right. He's a Russian, and he sold some arms, and he conspired. He made threats to have some U.S. nationals killed, and he's being held, serving a sentence of 25 years. Okay? All right. Okay. Putin wants him released.
Yep.
Putin wants him free. Okay? So, and it's two of them, Slim. It ain't just Brittany Griner. It's that dude Whelan. Paul Whelan.
He was arrested and accused of spying December 28, 2018. He's currently serving a 16-year bid in Russia.
Yeah, he's over there. So at the end of the day, the United States going to have to cut a deal because we got something Putin won't, and Putin they got something we won't. So he's going to have to cut the deal.
Cut the check, exactly. Mm-hmm. Trial number two, a hearing with the NFL Disciplinary Office Officer Susan L. Robinson, a retired judge, last Thursday. Robinson asked for the post-hearing briefs, which will be due the week of July 11th. She told a source at ESPN, Sue is expected to take her time, but she's expected to be the judge of the Browns report before the Browns report to camp July 27th. What's your take, Coach?
Yeah, she's going to make her decision. That's what she say. She's going to take her time. Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Well, you go on and take your time, Sue Robinson. Let's understand this, Slim. Follow the money. Okay?
Yep.
Let's look at everybody involved in this Deshaun Watson hearing thing. You got Sue Robinson, a woman judge. You've got the NFL Players Association. All of this ain't nothing but drama. Slim, I used to hate it in the summertime when I was a little kid and it would rain. Because let me tell you what your granny, she watched them stories. Slim, so drama. Of night. folks a little old, the younger will remember Dallas.
Who shot JR? Who shot JR?
Who shot JR? Drama. This ain't nothing but drama. Follow the money. Because look at the whole scenario, Slim. Everybody, you got a lot of women. A lot of women across the country who are offended because they didn't even want Deshaun Watson. They want Deshaun Watson in jail. Understand, like, assault against women is real. Okay? That's real. And this is a touchy subject, okay? Mm-hmm. But I promise you, Slim, Jim Haslam done paid Deshaun Watson $230 million. And he ain't concerned about it. Let me tell you something, partner. Jimmy Haslam.
Ain't waiting.
Jimmy Haslam, listen, don't you think it's a little ironic that it's a woman who's judging this? Let me tell you, if it's a man who was the judge and he gives Deshaun Watson a clean slate, don't make him miss a game, or says he gives him a sentence of 4, maybe 6 games, then that's a man, okay? That's a man. And all the women across the country are going to be mad. And they mad already. But when this woman gives Deshaun Watson 4, maybe 6, or don't be surprised if he don't get none, Slim, you don't pay a man $230 million fully guaranteed that you know you not going to have his services. And no. Jimmy Haslam keep talking about, we're going to trust
him. Trust the legal system.
Thank you. It's the drama, legal system. Slim, all this ain't nothing but drama. The edge of night. That's all this is, drama. Just like them soap operas. Boy, let me tell you something, your granny didn't play about them. She called them her stories. Hush, boy, my stories is on. And that's this whole thing ain't nothing but drama. And everybody's sitting on the edge of their chair waiting to see who shot JR. And them soap operas gave you just enough to make sure you watch the show when it come on the next week.
Because it's just like Denzel said in Training Day, Coach. It entertains me. It's entertaining.
Thank you.
But let's be real, Coach. Let's be real. 45 then already said he grabbed women by the private parts.
Look, come on, bingo. Now. You're right. Listen, why you talking about assault? This country elected a president that gloated in grabbing women in their private parts. Okay? So just understand. But at the end of the day, Slim, I'm saying 4 games tops. Four games tops. And Slim, I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't miss a game. Me personally. Mm-hmm.
Now, Coach, we got to talk about some hoops because we got a whole bunch of trades going on and everything like that. Kevin Durant has said he's done with the Nets. He's trying to leave. He don't want to be there no more.
He's tired of Kyrie's mess. And well, he should be. I'm going to tell you something, Slim. Kevin Durant is a dynamic player. He's not a dynamic leader. He's a dynamic player. He is not a dynamic leader, okay? And he say, I'm done with this Kyrie Irving mess. Find me a new home. He's demanding a trade, okay? And I personally hope that he goes to Golden State. Golden State let Boston win 2 games in the series for the NBA championship. If they'd have had Kevin Durant, they'd have swept them. Now, the only thing about that is on the other side of the coin, does Golden State have enough capital to merit that trade? I saw what they talked about. They're going to throw Wiggins in the mix and 2 or 3 more guys.
Kevon Looney and Jordan Poole and Andrew Wiggins, I've heard, is the talk plus a couple picks.
Yeah. But, so I tell you, the team to look for, though, Sam, I'm telling you, a dark horse in this whole thing. Don't be surprised if Toronto doesn't get him, because they got enough star quality players to put up in a trade.
Star quality players and capital room, coach. Plus, they already have championship DNA when Kawhi Leonard took them to the championship. Okay. Now, if you ask me, KD's going to be a little bit hard to trade for because he's under contract for 4 years. In my opinion, he's going to the Miami Heat. He's already voiced he wants to go to Miami. He wants to play with Bam. He wants to play with Jimmy, and he wants to be with Kyle Lowry if they can keep all three of them people collected together.
We're going to see. We're going to find that real close. Yeah, ain't no question. All right.
Pleasure being in the studio with you again, Coach, man. This was a treat.
Always, Mike, man.
You got me a published author this time. This was awesome.
Hey, man, and I'm telling you, bro, I'm going to read Figure It Out. Because you can bet, man, Mike Westhoff, man, that brother has figured it out. No question.
Tell him I love him, all right?
I will, bro. Give my best to everybody up in Dell City, Oklahoma. I can't come to see that dog, man.
I'm telling you, Coach, you get big.
I got to see that bulldog. I'm a cute.
I see some pictures.
All right. Okay. And finally, as Little League football season commits, all you moms and dads, let the kids play. Okay? You're sitting on the sideline with your Diet Pepsi and you're having a good time with your handheld camera. Let the kid play. You ain't the coach. Let the coach's coach, you tell him, get up in the morning, eat your breakfast, go to school. He gonna obey your orders. Don't make him obey your orders trying to coach him from the sideline. The game's played too fast and too physical, even for little kids, for him to be on that field trying to play and listening for what you got to say. Okay? Let the coaches coach. And hey, that's how I see it. 6 o'clock, straight up and down.
Are you taking your own advice, Coach? You got to, because you don't know how many times you was yelling out there at me and I'm trying to play a football game.
Yeah, okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's how we see it, and that's how it is.
Thank God we get
to do this again. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning into this week's episode of Homespun Sports. Sports talk with a twist of Down Home Wisdom. We thank you so much, Coach Mike Westhoff, for being our special guest on episode 41 of Homespun Sports. Be sure not only to catch this episode on YouTube, but on iHeartRadio and Spotify for your listening and viewing pleasure. We want you to stay updated with all of our content when it comes out to you. We don't want you to miss anything. So make sure you got that bell turned on so you don't miss any of our videos. Stay subscribed. Hit the comments. Hit the like button. We appreciate it, and we will respond back. We love y'all, and stay subscribed. Hey, Coach.
Yeah, buddy.
Let's go ahead and get up out of here, man.
Hey, you said nothing but a word. Appreciate you coming on, Mike. Real talk.
Real talk.
One, two, three.